It is administered by the American Mathematics Society and is awarded every 2 years at this meeting. Professor Corma is a widely recognized contributor to the science and technology of heterogeneous catalysis. He has participated in the discovery of industrial catalysts for the isomerization of like strand from naphtha, the upgrading of bolons in FCC units, the selective oxidation of propylene, the selective isomerization of alpha olefins by weakly basic solid catalysts, and the isomerization of beta pyrene. His current research field is zeolites as catalysts, their synthesis, characterization, and reactivity in acid base and reduced catalysis. He has about 450 articles in international journals, 3 books, and several reviews and book chapters. Such intensive scientific research has been the basis for the technological applications developed by his group. Professor Corma is a member of the editorial board of several journals, for instance, Journal of Catalysis, Molecular Catalysis, Catalysis with New Sciences Engineering, among others. He also has received several awards from the PONT, the Chiappetta Award in 1998, the François Bolo from the European Society, and several others from the Spanish government. It's very a good occasion for us to be in contact with Professor Avelino Corma.
Better now?
Yes.
First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for setting such a nice congress in a beautiful place like here. I would like also to thank the different companies that are supporting and SUCEMIG, certainly, by keeping these awards during the years. In my talk today, I am going to tell you what has been our driving lines in the research we have been doing in the group. I will show you how we have tried to introduce concepts and how those concepts, when we work together in close collaboration with companies, in some cases, they have yielded at the end industrial applications. The point I would like to make for starting is that for us working in academia is only interesting and rewarding when we strongly collaborate and interact with the companies. Then that is important and can bring results. We are not interested just in getting the money, working in our things, and then from time to time to meet. It has to come from very close collaboration. Today I will show you some examples trying to illustrate the work we did. Talking about catalysis, certainly the big word is selectivity. Selectivity in this case is important because it's the why of catalysis. If we talk about selectivity, then we can concentrate on enzymes. In the case of enzymes, they had many years, nature had many years, through many genetic algorithms and combinatorial processes, to reach highly selective catalysts. In this case, we have the active site, and the active site normally is one or two metal atoms whose activity is modified by the ligands they have around. If that will be all the principle for the activity and selectivity in the case of enzymes, it will be very easy for our very good coordination chemists to carry on enzyme mimics just by performing and making those transition metal complexes. However, one enzyme is more than that. The enzyme starts to control already selectivity, not just from the active site, but already when the molecules are approaching. And for that reason, it has developed all these proteinic groups to make reaction channels to approach the molecules in the right way. And not only to approach the molecules, but to approach the right molecule and to carry on the absorption in the proper way of the active site. That means that if we go into our solid catalyst, sorry for putting this that all of us we know very well, but I put it because what I was taught, and we keep passing the message, is that on the different steps that we have, diffusion in the pores, absorption on the surface, and then reaction on the active site, we always concentrate on reaction on the active site. And we used to tell to our students that here is where we have to get our activity and our selectivity, and what we have to do is to get rid of those steps as soon as possible during the catalytic process. That which is formally true from the point of view of the rate of the reaction is not necessarily so when you want to maximize the selectivity of your catalyst. Remember that in the case of the enzyme was already controlling the selectivity since the first step by diffusing the reactants through the channels, the molecular channels being made, and also by the proper absorption of your reactants on the active site. So maybe we could try to do the same in the case of solid catalysts. Of course, it's difficult with inorganic materials to get the flexibility that you get in those proteins in the enzyme. Because we cannot get that big flexibility, what we can do otherwise is to go and to prepare now structures with different pore size, hoping that we can find the right pore size to select the diffusion of the molecules through the pores. If now we start to control selectivity through the pores by molecular sieving, and we can control also the absorption properties, if we can introduce the active sites in such a structure, we should have a powerful catalyst. You see the properties of these materials, and you see that they have molecular dimensions in the pores. That means that we can start to act in the diffusional process as molecular sieves. High absorption capacity and concentration effects that will bring then the molecules together inside of the cavities, increasing the frequency factor, and therefore increasing, in that case, the rate of the reaction. One can go one step further and then try, in this case, to control also the polarity of the material, and in this way to gain extra selectivity. Finally, possibility for controlling number and strength of active sites. With all that, we should be able to make selective catalysts. You can then, in the next step, to introduce acid sites, or basic sites, or redox sites, or even to use them as catalyst supports. I will go through a couple of those type of catalysts. First, we'll start with acid catalysis. In the case of acid catalysis, when you make a zeolite and you make it just with pure silicon, you have a silicon tetrahedrally coordinated, and that gives you a neutral framework. If you want to introduce acidity, what you can do then is to substitute one of those silicons by a trivalent element, put aluminium, for instance, that when it's tetrahedrally coordinated, generates a negative charge in the structure that can be compensated by one proton. In this case, you can change the number of active sites simply by changing the number of those five elements. You can change also the strength of those sites by changing the electronegativity of the trivalent or the tetravalent atom. If you put boron, for instance, you will decrease the acid strength, and that will be quite interesting for many reactions. On the other hand, just by controlling, in this case, the silicon molecule ratio, by making zero next nearest neighbors of aluminum in that aluminum, is when you get the maximum electronegativity and therefore the maximum density of positive charge into hydrogen, and therefore the maximum massive strength. If now you start to change silicons with aluminiums, you will decrease electronegativity, and then you will decrease the density of charge here. What will happen is that you will increase the total number of sites, and the acid strength will decrease. Introducing more and more aluminium to the next nearest neighbors, or even aluminium, you modify in that way also the acid strength. In nice interesting work, several fellow of us, like Bartomev, Alan Peters, Bob Bacher, they made what could be a theoretical distribution of those sites that I was talking. Zero next nearest neighbors, there will be the strongest one you can get, then one next nearest neighbors, and therefore now you can select the type of size that you want depending on the acid strength that your reaction needs. That would be one way to get selectivity when you have different reactions competing and you can select the right acid strength. If you want maximum strength, you will come into zero next nearest neighbors. That will be, if you look into silicon ratio, something around 10, or a small unit cell size in the case of YC. So we have a method there to control the number and the acid strength of your molecular sieve catalyst. With those bases, I will start to talk about some examples that we work on, and of course FCC is mandatory since this is the outline of the lecture. I will talk about the work we did on FCC and light spectrum isomerization in the first part when talking about oil refining. This was a milestone publication coming from Exxon. In that time, I want to believe also this time, when companies were really pushing to also bring fundamental knowledge and concepts into the pool of science that we all are trying to make. In that excellent paper, what they were relating was the activity of any FCC catalyst that you make based on white zeolite with the concepts I was telling you before. Total number of aluminiums that they represent by the unit cell size. And they found what they call a universal parameter to correlate activity with units and cell size or amount of aluminium. In that time, we were working there also in that field, and we said, okay, if this is the universal parameter, independently how you get that composition into your structure, you should get the same final properties. So then we were making families of Y zeolite in this case with different framework aluminium contents prepared by different ways. And as you can see, there differences were observed. And not only quantitative, but also qualitative differences, indicating that besides that framework composition we were talking, were other parameters that play also one important role. We are talking in FCC not about small molecules, model molecules. We are talking about heavy vacuum gasoil or even resin. In that case, it's very clear that your zeolite is going to act to transform those large molecules only on the surface. So it will become as important, or I would say even more important for conversion, than the total number of sites, those sites that can be reached from the exterior for the molecules. Those will increase when you will increase the external surface area of your crystal. One way to do that is to calculation procedure, in that case, in where you are making now mesopores into the structure. In that case, you are generating more and more porous mouth opening into the exterior, in where your big molecules are going to stick and react. So textural properties will be very important. And indeed, taking the two families, you see how if we look into that mesoporosity, we can see that it's very difficult, very different, depending on the method of preparation that you are using. To check that, we did the following. We took small molecule that can penetrate inside very easily and is going to see all the active sites. So the activity will not depend on the textural properties. One, the illuminated by silicon tetrachloride lighting, classical by steam. By steam you destroy more, so you see that with a small molecule you get higher activity for this one. When you go into vacuum gasoil with large molecules, just the opposite occurs. So in that case, we were getting more of those mesopores, and therefore higher accessibility and higher compression. Those of you who are familiar with FCC will say, well, this is nice, it's fundamental research, it's one exercise, because at the end, your material, your catalyst, you'll find in the regenerator, big conditions, and anyway, those will be the textural properties. My answer is yes and no. No, because you can also make more accessible external surface area by preparing your Y0 with the smaller crystallites. And in that case, independently, researchers like Grace and ourselves, we made smaller crystallites. But they were not stable. But in our case, we made it with high silicon to aluminum ratio, by synthesis, higher. They were stable, giving higher activity. That started a very nice collaboration with Engelhard. Working with them very closely, we were successful in making small crystallites by in situ synthesis in the pores of the matrices, and they were stable because we synthesized with large silicon protein pressure, and the benefit was clear not only on activity, but also on selectivity, producing less dry gas and coal. Okay, that is textural. But it's more. We were thinking that when you go and doing steaming, or you go into the regenerator, you are removing aluminum from the frame. And that aluminum stays in your zeolite. But it migrates, as we saw from XPS, it migrates into the surface in such a way that you get silicon to aluminum ratios bulk, the same that you started, 2.8, in framework. Lower, a higher silicon to aluminum ratio, lower amount of aluminum, you dealuminate, and then in your surface, that aluminum was accumulated. And then came a concept working on extra framework aluminum. If that alumina comes out and stays highly dispersed on the surface, we can make a simple association. What catalyst manufacturers they do when they want to increase conversion, for instance? They use matrices, active matrices, and one can be highly reactive, highly surface aluminum. So in this case, we were having highly dispersed extra framework aluminum on the surface. And certainly, if that was on the surface, this will be the first thing that the large molecules will find. So they will find a highly dispersed active alumina, and there they will crack. So this should have the positive effect of cracking the large molecules, and the negative effect that just like active alumina does, generate more dry gas and coal. What to do then? So we made two proposals to companies working in this field. We said, we would like, following this idea, to preserve the benefit of that extra framework aluminium and to eliminate the dry gas and coal they will form, to decrease them. And the way we want to do it is by introducing into your catalyst, into the matrix, a highly reactive silica. Then that silica will react with extra framework aluminium that will be coming out and will form here amorphous type of silica aluminum. They prepared that. And the red one was the catalyst they prepared with highly reductive silica in the matrix as a component. That would be the conventional one. As you can see, by doing that, the activity was increased because we were getting that tracking outside. What is important is the dye gas decreased, the distillates increased, and coke didn't change. So that was already one improvement, not depending on the unit cell size, but depending on the formulation and on the concept of extra framework agreement. The other line of attack was during the activation, they did the commercially, they can take away part of that extra framework convenient. And when they do that, you see the dry gas comes down and coke comes down. So you get more selective catalyst that allows you to go into higher catalyst cooperation or higher temperature control. That concept of extra framework aluminium and taking care of that was the basis for our collaboration with one of those companies and the family of ADZ FCC catalysts that were commercialized. That was on the core of the cracking, on the zeolite, the very active compound. What about the matrices? Back in 1979, when I came back from Canada for my postdoctoral, I saw that we were the biggest producer in Spain of a material called cellulite. Cellulite was made by tetrahedras of silica and octahedras of magnesium, with channels that unfortunately they were also only accessible to polar molecules. However, interestingly, those materials, they had no exchange capacity or anything like that. So not too much freedom to work with them as a catalyst. However, looking into the terminal magnesiums, they were slightly out of the central position, and they were also coordinated by two molecules of water. That was a new option into the framework. So we achieved, by one indirect way, to substitute those magnesiums by aluminium, and then generating very mild acidity. They could be used, we thought, for bottoms and gravity. In that case, we compared the results with amorphosilic alumina, showing that indeed we were having their mild acid catalyst that were able to convert vacuum to solid for even the silica. Looking into the gases, lower gases, lower coke, that was an important parameter, and the higher diesel that was indicated that we were getting higher bottoms and grain. This was one unexpected issue. We were getting less hydrogen transfer, and that is a big help when you try now to use this in combination with conventional catalysts to carry on the bottoms and grain. This finally, together in collaboration with Bolsa and Intercat, was met in an industrial amount, and it went into a refinery, showing that was as good as, at least, as the best bottom cracking additive that they had. But importantly, because of this issue, when combined with additives such as ZSM5, it was producing at the end all the formulation more appropriately. Also, as you see, important vacuum for when you drink the seed, it was passivating and nitrogen. What are we doing now about FCC? It would be nice, for sure, to get larger for zeolites. The ones made up to now are unidirectional, and therefore not good for FCC or catalytic cracking. We are working on making extra large for tri-dimensional zeolites, and we came with one that it has the same aperture, the white zeolite, same cavity inside, about the same. But instead of four entrances into the cavity and four exits, therefore, this has six. So that means that the products you form can diffuse much easier, and therefore less hydrogen transfer occurs, and this makes almost the same amount of propane that when you combine the USY and ZSM5 as it is being done today. The inconvenience, however, is the cost. So we have to do fundamental research. Then maybe we'll improve working with the companies into the cost. Additives is an important issue in FCC. FCC will become more a petrochemical supplier for industry and therefore additives. We want to make now materials in which we can control the different porosity and combination of porosity additives. Presently, we made together in collaboration with Exxon, in this case, a material which has 9 and 10 membrane pores, high dimension. So this gives higher amounts of property in the centers of fire. Then we'll have to go down into the cost. So this was 9 and 10. We made another 8, 10, and 12. I will pass fast because I can not show you. Then we go into others with 10 and 12. With all this combination of pores, we should be able now to get special effects on selectivity. We are working also into what will be the future FCC by designing new type of laboratory reactors such as the microdoubler. During our work in FCC, we saw what was put by people like Bartolev, and was put also by people like Bernard Hack, saying that when you have extra framework aluminium there, then you can have also an enhancement of bronsted acidity by interacting extra framework with the bronsted sites. If that is the case, we cannot use that concept for FCC, because at the end, in the high temperatures of the steamer, those species will be destroyed. However, we can use it for other processes where no high temperatures for regeneration are needed. We prove it that those were very strong acid sites by looking into the shift of the infrared bands. And then we try to make use of that concept in the case of light strain run isomerization. In light strain run isomerization, what you want to do is to isomerize normal pentene that has low octane number and normal acid that has low octane number into a branched products. The technologies for doing that, as you know very well, are chlorinated alumina, platinum, and more than that, each one having advantages and disadvantages. You remember what I told you before, and remember also that those catalysts are extremely sensitive to sulfur. Now, what is done by industry, or what was done by industry to optimize those catalysts to get the maximum acid strength. What they did was to dealuminate by acid treatment the modernite, and as you see, indeed, the maximum is obtained about 10 silicon tolerant ratio, as was said before when I was talking. Others, what they do was steam or steam acid treatment. In any of those treatments, when you do that, either acid leaching or steam acid, you are removing the interesting extra framework species that was saying before. So we went into another direction. What we were doing is first removing some of the aluminium by acid leaching and then by mild steaming generating the extra framework species. Look at that, in this case, the activity was higher, but especially what was very important is that we could achieve high activity or the same activity you want at higher silicon toluene ratio. And that has two important implications for commercial application. One is that by working with higher silicon toluene ratios, in that case, you coke less, so you use less hydrogen in your process. The second, that by working with higher silicon toluene ratios, your metal should be more resistant to salt. Just to prove you that concept of framework as the framework, you see clearly one optimum there that we try to get when making the catalyst. This was taken by Cepsa and Suzuki, and they made and extrapolated that catalyst and made it commercial and commercialized for light stray rock. That went first in that plant at Cepsa and then in many other plants. And that is the important issue. The important issue is that, as I was telling you, this catalyst, the isobar, now can work at much higher amounts of sulfur than the one that was used before. A couple of examples working on chemicals and fine chemicals. Another concept. When you deal with large molecules and you deal with molecular sieves, what you want in that case is accessibility. You can make it by the small crystallites. But what we did there was to take some of the zeolites that they grow by liars, stop the synthesis before those liars that were coming together and forming the tridimensional, and then at that point expanding and delaminating. Now what you have is a crystalline material there with well-defined structure and extremely high surface area. We have made several of those, like ITQ6 from ferrite, ITQ18, ITQ20, that we don't know still the structure. The important issue is that it's still crystalline, still acidic, of course, but now the external surface goes from something like 130 for this to 800, or from 53 to 800. So we increase that external surface area we wanted to deal with large molecules. The first example, of course, was to apply for benzene alkylation with propylene. That would be the MCN22, and that on one of the family, as you know, is ExxonMobil's catalyst for alkylation. The reaction occurs on the cups at the external surface, and therefore, by delaminating, we reduce the activity. Of course, we are at high activity, because here we wanted to look at very important issue, normal propylene formation. You don't want propylene benzene formation, and we are making less of that. Okay. If now you increase the weight hour space velocity, for those of you who are familiar with those type of processes, this is incredibly high weight hour space velocity. At that moment, already the MCN22 starts to fill the low contact time, but we still have much higher activity with the 29. So that was transferred to a company that is a leading company and making the alkylation catalyst, but I am sure they will take good profit. Let's move now into something that smells better. Fragrances. Fine chemicals. In this case, I will tell you about fragrances from acetates. You carry on and you make those products with blossom, vanilla, apple scent, or acid by acetalization of ketones and aldehydes. This is a facile reaction that normally is done in industry by using inorganic mineral acids or organics such as pentobarbital sulfonic acid. Let's take a look at one example, and we'll skip the others. The fructon. The fructon, you do it, for instance, with paraben sulfonic acid, and the yields that are obtained are around 75%, maximum 80%. The problem is that with the conventional acids, you come and you hydrolyze also the fructon and you get the acid that smells very badly. Then if you want a fragrance, you have to heavily distillate if you reduce the amount of that. Just by taking two large more zeolites and bringing it there, that is what one would do just empirically. You see already that we are improving the yields from 80 to 90, still get some amounts of the acid. But we know that by applying the concepts, we can go one step further. We have to think there that we have two reactants with different polarity. Active sites are okay, but if you have reactants with different polarity, now you have to control the absorption properties, because you want both of them to diffuse inside and to carry on the right absorption. So in this case, we have to optimize the polarity of our molecule, of our reactant, excuse me, and you see how by changing the composition, we are increasing now the hydrophobicity, making less polar. And then you can optimize the different materials, not from the point of view of your acid size, because the maximum activity should be there from what we saw before. However, we have it shifted into lower albedos, much lower, because you want the right polarity. That is what is obtained in that case. By making hydrophobic, now you can change also the process. Because instead of using toluene reflux to remove the water that you form and to shift the equilibrium, now you can use the hydrophobic material, and just by using commercial vacuum, you can achieve now 99% selectivity, 94% yield. This was for Apodicent, using the other concepts I told you before about controlling transition state and controlling also the pore dimensions. We went into the other ones that I just passed past. And this was done together with Acidis and Pagasaco. They did already in pretty large amount, you know, they call large pilot plants, and they are ready for commercialization of those plants. In the last part of my talk, I will tell you about oxidation catalyst. Remember that in enzymes, we said that we want isolated active sites. Isolated, all of them the same and well controlled. Any researcher and any chemist came with a beautiful material that was titanium 775, where titanium was in the framework in the right combination, and they opened a new line of work where they could carry out many reactions using hydrogen peroxide. However, in an excellent work from Professor Tatsumi, that is keeping doing very nice work in this field, he showed that that was okay when you want to deal with the small molecules that can diffuse. But if you want to go into larger molecules, then the activity strongly comes down when you go into larger molecules. So we had to look for other types of materials, and we decided in that time not to work on CS1, but on large pores. We succeed finally in making titanium beta with aluminium steel, because it was believed in that time that the sample had to be prepared with aluminium as the nuclei with aluminium. First surprise was that even though the coordination was the same, the intrinsic activity of the titanium beta for a molecule that can easily diffuse in the two of them was low. The benefit, however, was observed when you went into larger molecules. However, if you want the bauxite, in other case, the selectivity was very low. Not surprising, because in our case, by making with aluminium, we did not stop the reaction here, but with water and acid sites that opened and gave light. So we had to remove and make the synthesis without aluminium, and we attacked it in three different directions. I will tell you about the city. We still believe, like was said in the literature, that we need aluminium for nucleation. So we made very small nucleus there, with aluminium, 10 nanometer, remove the aluminium and use that to nucleate, and then grow it without any aluminium. Now, we have a material that practically has no aluminium, and as you see, the turnover number increases, and so does the selectivity. That is not enough, that selectivity. Because there is another factor. We are trying to make to react very polar hydrogen peroxide in water, with a non-polar one, which is the hydrocarbon. Again, we have to control the polarity of our catalyst. If you do beta zeolite, all of you are familiar, you know that it has many defects, many silos. So that creates a hydrophilic material. We did the synthesis in fluoride media, and then in that case, we can get materials that can absorb 150 times more normal exchange than water, so highly hydrophobic. Now we can move from highly hydrophilic to highly hydrophobic and to optimize that. See now, both of them, this with defects, this without defects, to normal increases, but now we have already high selectivities, we are in a good point. We could use now for things of commercial interest, such as would be the epoxidation of fatty esters. And again, you see when going from the defect to the one without defect, you increase strongly the conversion and you increase the selectivity. Many more materials we could make in that way. We can make them also reactive with organic peroxides, of course. We were first making in those mesoporous materials the titanium. And those were active and selective, especially when you succeed now in controlling again the absorption properties by making organic, inorganic materials during the synthesis or by post-chemical treatment. You get high conversions and selectivities higher than 99%. We can make also from the delaminated novels. And finally, one of our materials, together with a very close collaboration with Sumitomo, gave rise to a new process for making propylene oxide from propylene using fluorine hydroperoxide as the oxidant, and the plant successfully started in April, and I went invited to visit. To finish my talk, I will tell you about that new reaction, or not new reaction, but about new catalysts that opens new perspectives in an important industrial field such as the making lactose. This work we did again in close collaboration with UOP and with Laszlo Nemeth. Laszlo Nemeth was working heavily also together with us on that subject. As you know, commercially this is done with peracids, and then you carry on and you form the lactone and you generate one molecule of acetic acid. But now, to make the peracid, you have to react the annealing, the acetic anhydride with hydrogen peroxide. Again, you form the peracid and also acetic acid. So you are forming large amount of acetic acid just to get one molecule of lactone. The purpose then was to avoid that. But not only to avoid that, but to make a chemoselective catalyst that could open now new possibilities that you cannot have working with peracids, either liquids or solids, such as the chemoselectivity. When you have other groups there, if you use the peracids, you are going to obtain a mixture of those. If we succeed in obtaining in those cases only that, we could open for making completely new products that they were not before. Of course, people are intelligent, eh? They were trying to do that by using hydrogen peroxide, but they were using the following concept. In the case of the carbonyl group, you do not have a high density of charge here, so then you have to activate your hydrogen peroxide to make it more nucleophilic. But when you activate your hydrogen peroxide with organic metallic complexes, indeed, the problem is that then you oxidize everything that you have there. So we started from another concept. I would say just very simple common sense. If we want to activate the carbonyl group, why not to activate the carbonyl group? Let's concentrate on that. That is what we want to do. Then if we use a Lewis acid, we could polarize that bond. We will increase the density of charge here, and now the hydrogen peroxide that was not nucleophilic enough to attack this, it will be able to attack that, and then to give a dent in the lactone. What Lewis acid to select? Well, remember that what we wanted is to polarize the carbonyl bond, but we do not want to form peroxides because the peroxides will also oxidize other groups. So we look into a series of elements that we could maybe introduce into the structure. Titanium, okay, but titanium will also form peroxide. So vanadium, chrome, manganese, none of them were suitable for going into our concept. Finally, it was one that had the right charge to radio ratio and were reported not to form peroxide. So then we could use that maybe to make the polarization. Well, that just to show that when we did the synthesis, we introduced into the framework and we had the coordination. Let's go into the catalysis. We use now the thing beta, the thing is in the framework. And as you see now with hydrogen peroxide, we could obtain high turnover numbers, but the selectivity to the lactone was extremely high. It was very good. So that was the first step. But this is the second step to go. And the second was chemoselectivity. That means that when now we have, for instance, a double bond, we want to get the lactone. We don't want to get the other product. If you do it in a conventional way with metachloropentenoic acid, you use the actual existing technology, you will find that you obtain a mixture of products. The chemoselectivity is very bad. You use titanium beta, you obtain other properties. You use your sorrenium, and you obtain low conversions and gain low selectivities. You come with in beta, you obtain practically 100% selectivity to the desired product. That is working, so let's prove if the hypothesis was true. First step, absorption, polarization. For doing that, we work with in situ infrared in that case. Pure silica was not interacting with the carbonyl groups. When we went now with the team beta, you see the shift of the band of the carbonyl groups, and that band associated with the polarization of the carbonyl group by the Lewis still remain at temperatures right in the range of the oxidation reaction. So the first step was proved by in situ ion. What would be the intermediate? And this is dedicated to my friend Enrique Iglesias. He showed us that we should go into the mechanism also. And then we wanted to know the intermediate. And for that, we labeled in the carbonyl group with oxygen in the end. We have three possibilities. We can make as an intermediate a carbonyl oxide. We can make a deoxycidane or a green atom. If we have the intermediate as a carbonyl oxide, then we should get 100% transposition migration of the oxygen from the carbonyl to the other position. If we go through the deoxycidane, we should get 50% migration and 50% remaining of the carbon. Now we get a green atom, we should get 100% product in where the oxygen is remaining, the label oxygen in the carbon. Then we carry on the reaction. We feed the reactant here with the oxygen in the carbon group, and we obtain 100% of the oxygen into the carbon. Then we have now the complete picture of the mechanism. First step will be the polarization, increasing the density of the charge. Second step, the attack, and forming the green atom, and later the absorption and leaving the vacuum. That was the mechanism of the reaction. I started with enzymes, and I'm going to finalize with enzymes. Being so selective, we wanted to check if they were enzymes able to do lactose. And we found in the literature one enzyme that was reported for performing and getting the lactone, and in this case was also in the presence of an olive. Again, you take beta-chlorocarbenzoic acid, you get high conversions, no problem, but then you are getting a mixture of the product. With enzyme, 100% of the desired mark, with the team beta, we were getting also 100%. This work that was done, as I said, in close collaboration with UOP. UOP is now developing the process for making lactose using CRISPR. I would like to finish saying to you a couple of philosophical words, saying that I feel I am a very privileged person. I am very privileged because, first of all, I like very much what I am doing. I like research very much. Secondly, because I had a big chance of starting a new institute from zero. Well, it was not completely from zero. It was empty labs for $100,000. At all, it was all I had. We started 10 people, we finished with that. This was not possible if two people were not with me, supporting continuously and helping to build that. One is Amparo Mitsud, that is together with us, the other is Vicente Fornés. Then, in the case of Amparo Mitsud, she not only does the microscopy, but she is taking care of the administration and leaving me free to be able to do the research that I like. So that I will never say thanks enough to her for doing that. He said when we started in the bad times, he was taking care of all the characterizations, setting all the apparatus, setting all the characterization techniques. And even though he already wears a white beard, He's still doing that and keeping all the characterization of the Danish problem. Thanks to them, we have made the institute and progress from 10 people to the group of very young people that you have there. That is all. Thanks to all of them and thanks to all of you for your kind attention.
Avelino, thank you very much. We see a very useful use of basic concepts for communications.
Thank you.
We have time for two questions, if some of you. Okay. Thank you very much.